second. I'm checking Twitter. Hold on just a second. Okay. Hold on. Okay, there we go. What's that? Seth texted me. Oh, that's awesome. YOLO. That's hilarious. Hey, okay, sorry. Don't you hate that? Don't you hate just waiting knowing that it's about to start? Okay, how long is this going to take? Have you, like, not on the work phone, on their personal phone texting and asking you to wait? Have you ever had that experience? Isn't that the absolute worst? Okay, I've worked in retail. Students and other people who work in retail, don't do that, okay? It's the worst. I hate waiting. I really hate waiting. I was in the airport yesterday, went to visit my family, and we had to wait for like an hour for our layover. And I think the airport time is slightly slower than time outside of the airport. And so even an hour, it's like, what on earth would a human being do with an hour? And I can waste all kinds of hours anywhere else in the world. But that 1 hour at the airport, how many of you would raise your hand and just confess you hate waiting? Are you really impatient? Okay, well, all of you are going to hate this sermon series. This is the first week in a new sermon series on waiting, waiting on all kinds of things. And it's also the first Sunday of the Christian season of Advent in the church calendar. Now, I didn't grow up doing the church calendar. Maybe you're unfamiliar as well. It's a way that Christians all over the world have kind of organized our time and our life together. So rather than just a January through December calendar, you know, which we use for school and for work, and, you know, it's convenient, everybody does it. In the church, we have this way of organizing our life, not around everything else that's going on, but around the story of the gospel. And so the first Sunday of Advent, which is today, is like Christian New Year's. And it begins with the season of Advent that leads to the celebration of Christmas and then Epiphany. And we have Ash Wednesday, which will be March 1st next year. And then the season of Lent leading up to Holy Week and Easter and then Pentecost. And our whole year, if we follow the church calendar, all of us are living into the story of the gospel. And so we have times during our year where we're celebrating and times where we're reflecting and we're repenting. And during the season of Advent, we're repenting and remembering the first coming of Christ and remembering how it might have felt to be on the other side of that Christmas, that first Christmas, as the prophets had foretold the coming of a Messiah, and the people were waiting and they were waiting and they were waiting. But on this side of that first Christmas, we're still waiting. We're still anticipating and yearning and praying for that day to remake the heavens and the earth and to establish justice on the earth. A really fun thing to talk about. It's preferable to talk about so that you can adapt, or if you just do this, then this will happen. Waiting is no fun, because waiting we're often helpless in front of. And yet, as we look back at the story of Scripture, you know, like, waiting has been a central part of the lives of some of the greatest heroes of our faith. We would love to open up the Bible and see, if you just do this, then God will end this period of waiting. And yet we see again and again through Scripture and in our own experiences that God deliberately avoids doing that thing. That even though God in his omnipotence could press a button and make all of this waiting end, God doesn't do it. We look at the story of Abraham and Sarah, who were promised a child. And through that child, they would carry on the family name, and God would turn them into this great nation. And yet, decade after decade went by, and they still were childless until Sarah was 90 and Abraham was Sarah. At the last service, we had a woman, Louise Starkweather, who turns 103, and I told Louise, by the logic of God, you could be expecting a child anytime. We look at the story of Israel, who went down to Egypt, and there they were in a slavery for 400 years, generation after generation, crying out, God, how long is this going to go on? And maybe you're in a season of waiting right now, where you're waiting for a spouse. Or maybe you're waiting for a child like Abraham and Sarah, and so many of us have known the struggles of infertility or waiting to get pregnant. It's excruciating. It sure can be. It can be a real test of your faith. Maybe you're waiting for to gain meaningful employment. Maybe you're waiting for that wayward child to come back. Whatever it is for you, we all understand how it feels to wait and how powerless it can be in a season of waiting. And naturally, the question comes to our mind, and we pray, God, how long is this going to last? And we find that when we're in that season and we're praying that prayer, that we're actually in great company. Because when we open up the Psalms, we find people like David who prayed that very thing. David said, "My soul is in deep anguish. How long, Lord? How long?" Elsewhere he wrote, "How long must I wrestle with my thoughts and day after day have sorrow in my heart? How long will my enemy triumph over me?" Elsewhere, "How long, Lord, will the wicked rejoice?" And you know, for as many times as I have asked this question, and as many times as I've seen someone like David, a man after God's own heart, ask this question, do you know how many times I've heard a straight answer from God? 0 times. We see the Apostle Paul in the New Testament who prayed his own version of a how long prayer. He described this thorn in his flesh. We don't know if this is a metaphor for some kind of physical sickness or a struggle with sin. There's something in Paul's life that is an irritant to him. He's struggling, he's wrestling, and he's praying, "God, take it away." This is what Paul writes. He said, 3 times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me, but he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness." And it seems to be the case as we're in this conversation about waiting, and it seems to be the case as we look at the great heroes of Scripture, that God leverages these seasons of waiting for our good. That there are things that can only happen in a season of waiting, and God wants us to take advantage of that. That there's wisdom and strength and character and perseverance, all kinds of things to be had in this difficult season of life, and God desires that for us. God does not necessarily cause those seasons of waiting, but he's with us and he's working in us in the middle of those. God uses these rather painful and trying seasons to invite us to divest all of our hope in ourselves and our ability to control outcomes, and to invest all of our hope in him who gives life and who gives hope to all. In the book, I love this book, Necessary Endings by Henry Cloud. Cloud talks about the differences between a wish and a hope. A wish is some kind of desired outcome that's not tied to objective realities for optimism. So it's something you want to be true, but there are no plans in place for that to happen. Hope, on the other hand, is a desire that is tied to objective realities. So I could say, man, I really want to lose 20 pounds. Actually, if I lost 20 pounds, I'd probably have to go to the hospital. But a person could say, I really want to lose 20 pounds. Wouldn't that be great? That's person A. Person B can say, I hope to lose 20 pounds, so I've signed up for a gym membership, and I've got a personal trainer, and I'm watching my diet. I'm taking care of the calories and the sugar, and I'm eating vegetables. If you were a betting person, would you put your money on person A, who wishes the weight away, or would you put your money on person B, who hopes and has a plan? Yeah, person B, obviously. When it comes to waiting for Christians, it seems like people wait, not just for Christians, it seems that people wait in one of two ways. When it comes, and I'm not talking about little things like waiting for the airplane, I'm talking about big picture things like waiting for peace on earth, or waiting for healing, or what we're talking about today, waiting for justice. Some people wait, but they have worldly wishing. It's, boy, I sure wish we could all just get along. That's a lot of the sentimentality of pop culture optimism. It's just wishing that we could wish our problems away. So people put their wishes and dreams onto political candidates and find that, man, that one disappointed just like the last one and the one before that. There's worldly wishing. But there's another option, and it's Christian hope. And Christian hope is different than worldly wishing because Christian hope is tied to the objective reality of the faithfulness of God demonstrated through history and through our own personal experience. And while worldly wishing ultimately leads to despair, Christian hope leads to endurance and perseverance and the development of character, even in a trying situation. And so as we progress through this season of Advent, we're talking about waiting and waiting on some big picture things: healing, peace, resurrection. We're waiting on our Savior. We're waiting on our King. And today we're talking about waiting on justice. We're going to be in Isaiah chapter 9. If you have your Bible, please open there. Isaiah is the first prophet in the Old Testament. If you don't have a Bible with you, please grab the pew Bible that's underneath your seat. We're going to be on page 1072. In response to the reverence we have in our hearts for God's word, let's please stand and read this together, Isaiah 9, verses 2 through 7. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as men rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end. And he will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness for that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. Thanks, you can be seated. This prophecy of Isaiah, this oracle, gives us a picture of unanticipated hope. A people who were living in deep darkness, who were destitute and had on their shoulders the weight of oppression. The victims of an endless cycle of war and violence have suddenly had an unforeseen change in circumstances, a reversal of fortune. In the darkness, a light appears. Isaiah uses the language of a harvest. Harvest comes after a season of sowing and waiting. And sometimes you wait a long time before that green thing pokes out of the dirt. They use the language of plunder. Well, plunder doesn't come until after the war. After the battle has been fought and the victory has been decided, we have a picture of completion. The light has come. The harvest is ready to be taken in. And the battle has been won and the plunder is being taken. Verse 4 describes this great turn of events like, as in the day of Midian's defeat. And the prophet is referring to this great episode in the book of Judges in the Old Testament, where the people of Israel, the tribes of Israel, were oppressed by the rival nation of Midian. And so God raised up a judge by the name of Gideon, who was timid and afraid, and God called him and said, Gideon, I've chosen you to lead my people to freedom. So Gideon amasses this great army, and God says, Gideon, you've got way too many people. And so they reduce the army, and God says, still too many. And they reduce again until Gideon is followed by only 300 men. And it's with that 300 men that Gideon, with God's help, topples the powers of Midian's, and they are free from the powers of the Midianites. The prophet was saying that in the same way that God overturned the Midianites with Gideon and those 300 men, God was going to do this miraculous act of liberation for his people. When God would remove the yoke of slavery and free them from all who opposed them and abused them. And then verse 5 is my favorite verse in this passage. Keep your Bible open. It says, every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, be fuel for the fire. God says, in this Gideon-like turn of events, God was going to make extinct the weapons of war. We wouldn't have use for weapons, for violence, for the warrior's boot. Can you imagine the day when we no longer need armies or police forces or security systems or locks on our doors? Can you imagine the day when you don't have to be fearful about somebody breaking into your house or to your car or somebody, you know, taking your child or something that you loved? Can you even imagine that reality? And all of us, you know, we're in South Tulsa here. We're having one life experience, but consider the world. Read this text empathetically through the eyes of someone else. Imagine that you're a Syrian and you have fled your home because of war, and you're in a refugee tent in Lebanon or Jordan. The average length of time that a refugee is in a refugee camp is 17 years. Imagine the weight on your shoulders as a parent thinking about your little kid in that tent. How would you feel if you read this text? Or imagine that you're a teenage girl living in Nigeria and you've been kidnapped by an extremist group. How would you feel if you read the text about the end of violence and injustice? Or how would you feel if you were living in an inner city in our country and you'd lost friend after friend after friend to either addiction, to drugs, or gun violence? Read the text empathetically through the eyes of someone who's had a completely different life experience from you and hear the good news with fresh ears. Then in the wisdom of God, there will come a time when injustice ceases, when violence is over and is a thing of the past. Against all odds, in the same way that God overturned the army of Midian with the power of 300 men, God will come someday, and this is the Christian hope, and put an end to suffering and injustice and war and violence and abuse as we have known it. And can you imagine what would happen if we lived in that kind of reality, if one day, like a line in the sand, the world forever changed? The world were forever established as a place of justice and righteousness and peace. People would freak out. There would be all kinds of parties and celebration and gratitude, and people would be looking around, man, who do we owe our thanks to? How on earth can we account for this ridiculous turn of events? And we look at verse 6. The text says, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given." The cause for hope, the cause for celebration is a baby? No. That's not how God would do it. God should take a cue from us and get together a committee, an exploratory committee, maybe call in a couple of consultants and get our best options on the table. We'll do some PSAs and see what we're doing, get some feedback from the people. No, God didn't do anything like us. How did God overturn the violence of the world? Through an infant, through a child. This was God's Gideon deliverance. This is the unexpected way that God has chosen to topple the powers that are oppressing God's people. The text says, and the government will be on his shoulders. I don't know about you, but the last year, 18 months or so of this election has not made me more optimistic or hopeful about government. Anybody else? It's been depressing. And in fact, I think about people who are younger than me who've maybe not seen as respectable, more respectable leaders. I think, man, the future of government is pretty bleak. And yet we see here the government will be on his shoulders. Isn't that great news? That one day trust is going to be interjected back into government when the anointed and the appointed Son of God bears on his shoulders the responsibility for leading and ruling the people. And this is this heir, this Son of God, this promised one who is coming, is not going to be restricted with term limits. He's going to be seated on the throne of David, and it's going to be an everlasting throne. We don't have to worry about the next guy or the next gal who's coming to rule after him, because his kingdom will have no end. It's going to be a kingdom of peace and righteousness forever. And then the text concludes, the zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. It says to me, it's God's great desire, it's God's burning passion to enact this reality that was long ago promised. To enact this reality when the government of the world is on the shoulders of God, and as a result, the people enjoy peace. There's no more suffering, and there's no more war, and there's no more violence. This is going to be accomplished by the eager enthusiasm of God by sending his Son to put the government on his shoulders. And this story and the season of Advent reminds us that even in the darkest of times, Christians can't lose hope. We have to remember, even when things are at their worst, that violence and injustice and war have a countdown clock attached to them. That Christ will come to establish peace and justice on earth. And so when the next tragedy comes, and it seems like it's coming every other week, we will grieve and we will cry just like everybody else. But because we have hope, we will say, this too will be made right. That God will not permit this to be the case forever. In a couple of weeks, people are going to start releasing year-in-review kind of articles and shows. Talk about the best movies and books of 2016, the top news stories of 2016, and I Googled this week that very thing, like top news stories of 2016. And I tell you, that was a depressing list to read through. You read about the ongoing war in Syria that I referenced, the greatest humanitarian crisis in the world. The continued threat of ISIS. You know, we heard the story of beheadings of Christians, of people who drove, someone who drove a bus through a crowd of people in Nice, France. Any number of shootings, even here in Tulsa. Racial tension has been a huge issue. We got the Zika virus. And I hesitate to even begin naming these things because I'm going to forget something that is just so important. I mean, so affected so many people. And yet I feel in the middle of this, and I hate to say this, that we're growing calloused, that we're being less and less affected by the weight of these events. And it's not that a shooting happened, it's that another shooting happened. It's not that a car bomb went off, it's that another car bomb went off. And this is the story that we're accustomed to hearing. And we hear it so often that we almost think it's normal, but we have to remember this should not be normal. And this is not how it will be forever. We're so accustomed to hearing these tragedies that we become desensitized to them and we're less and less appalled than we used to be. We have to remember that these things are not right and that God in His wisdom is going to do something about them. But unfortunately, as Christians, we've often not had a good framework for talking about it. You know, what does God think? Well, of course He hates war. Of course He hates death and violence. What's He going to do about it? Well, I don't really know. And sometimes we'll talk about the hope of heaven. Well, you know, so-and-so died, but they are in a better place. They're in God's presence, and that is so true. But the Christian hope is more than going to heaven or just going to heaven. It's better than just going to heaven. Because when we open up our Bibles to the very last two chapters, what we see is not all of us flying away on glory to heaven, but heaven flying down to us. I saw a new Jerusalem, John says, prepared like a bride prepared for her groom. The holy city coming down, God will reign among His people. We have to remember, especially when we're most tempted to be disillusioned and to lose heart, that the Christian hope is not escapism. It's not getting rid of these problems so someone else can think of them. It's God entering into the mess and once and for all doing something about it. And that's what Isaiah 9 is promising us, that in the wisdom of God, Christ, who first came at Christmas, will return, bringing healing to the nations, bearing the government on His shoulders, and establishing peace and justice on earth. A kingdom that's under the governance of God. And as Christians, as we live through this story throughout the year, we'll go past Lent and we'll come upon the celebration of Easter. We believe that the death and the resurrection of Jesus was the first domino to fall in the crumbling and the end of this world as we have known it. A world that is characterized by sin and death and violence and injustice. And the second domino to fall was the birth of the church, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on Pentecost. Because the church was supposed to be like an embassy of God's kingdom on earth. The church is designed to be a colony of healing and hope in the middle of a world that's only known sickness and darkness. The second domino to fall was the birth of the church, and that means that you and I have a part to play in the middle of this. And so the church, not just wishing like the rest of the world that things will be different, the church is anchored in hope. Anchored to the faithfulness of God revealed through His story. This prophecy by Isaiah was given nearly 700 years before the birth of Jesus. And yet Jesus, in the wise timing of God, came. And we can trust the words of Jesus that He said He would return. We can't lose hope because we have reason for it. And even in the middle of a season of waiting, we have responsibility. We have opportunity. And God in His grace gives us these glimpses of hope, gives us these glimpses that this too shall be made right. We see it when someone puts their faith in Jesus for the first time. I got to baptize someone a few weeks ago. I wish I had time to tell you their story right now. God is doing incredible things, even in the worst of it. People are coming to Christ in scores in these refugee camps. God's creating a vulnerability and a need, and He's doing something in the middle of it. I want to share with you a story that came out of a church in Dallas who saw an injustice and saw an opportunity, and God did something miraculous in the middle of it. I want you to watch this. Oh. Church, don't let your candle of hope burn out. Christ, who came at Christmas, will come again as he promised. Hallelujah. And we will call him Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And the stories we're going to hear of the healing that Christ brought when he returns, the family reunions we're going to experience, the resurrection we're going to see when Christ returns. We have to hold on to hope. We have to keep hoping. We have to keep laboring for hope. There are people in this world who have only wishful thinking to go on. They need to know the hope of Jesus Christ. They need to know that all is not lost and that this, even this too, will be made right. Until then, we work and we weep and we pray. Come, Lord Jesus, come. We are waiting. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, amen. Church, Chris and the band are going to lead us in a song, and I invite you to consider those people as we pray that you know need hope. Maybe they need to come to a Christmas Eve service with you. We heard a story, such a cool story, just a few weeks ago about someone who came to a Christmas Eve service in 2013, and God used that to start a domino effect in their lives, and they were baptized just a few months ago. Who in your world needs to know the hope of Jesus Christ? And then all of us, as we sing these words, are going to be reminded through song of the hope that's coming. Lift up your eyes. Hope is coming.